Hey guys, welcome to the Breakdown Podcast. This is our first episode since before Christmas. We were on a Christmas break, winter break from school. Got back and then just needed to take a week to get back into our schedules. We've got a great episode for you guys today. We're gonna open with a new segment called Three Questions, where we take the three questions that were posted on Flea Flicker Instagram. Talk about what you guys thought and give our takes on it as well. And then we're going to move on, cover the divisional round, talk about all the matchups, all the teams, and then preview for the conference championships this weekend.
So after yesterday's games, I put up a couple polls this morning. Start with the first one. Mm-hmm. Best divisional round team performance. Had a few lucky winners yesterday. Chiefs, Bengals, Eagles, Niners were the options. Bengals, surprisingly, won 42%. The next closest was Eagles at 25%. Next was best quarterback left in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And the picture was Joe Burrow. 58% of you said that Joe Burrow was the best quarterback left in the playoffs.
And I agree. With both of these so far, I agree. I want to say that the Eagles had the best performance last week. I think that the proof is in the picture. Like what we saw this past weekend, I think does show who the best teams in the NFL are.
Yeah, and I think honestly, Joe Burrow, we talked about this earlier. I think he's above Patrick Mahomes now.
Our last podcast episode was actually the one right after the first win of this current Bengals winning streak. And I remember on that podcast, something that we talked about was the Bengals and Browns coming down to the wire in the AFC North. And I think we had a few different viewpoints, and we were kind of struggling with the idea of who this Bengals team was. And a lot of that did revolve around Joe Burrow. And here we are, second straight year, AFC Championship weekend, and we're still talking about Joe Burrow. I think that that's just a task in itself that I think doesn't get enough praise. Back-to-back AFC championships for the first time in Cincinnati Bengals franchise history. The Bengals, without Joe Burrow playing, have never won a road playoff game. They're 3-0 with Joe Burrow. Like, they're 0-7 as a franchise, 0-10.
That's pretty crazy.
And then they're 3-0. I mean, that guy, he's a franchise changer indeed.
Heading into that game, Josh Allen and the Bills undefeated at home. In the playoffs, he was 3-0.
I didn't see that. I didn't know that.
Yeah. So.
I mean.
Impressive. Pretty impressive stuff.
The Bengals definitely did some stuff that a lot of people didn't see coming.
They played a more complete game. I think that was one of the best football performances I've seen like the entire season. Honestly, just like very complete. The defensive sound, great running game. They passed it when they needed to.
The Bills were top two in yards before making contact. So the running back, sorry, I phrased it incorrectly, but they were the best at limiting the amount of space a running back got before they were to come in contact with the defensive player. They allowed less than a yard before a defensive player would be making contact with the running back. The Bengals had 85 yards before contact on Sunday night.
Yeah, we'll get into that more. I love that stat, actually, because we'll talk about that in a little bit.
Yeah, no, we'll have time, but let's talk about that third question.
Yeah, that third question.
That was a pretty
intriguing one.
Will
Dak win another playoff game?
Lopsided.
24% of you said yes. The other 76% of you, hell no. And that probably makes sense. If you're not a Cowboys fan, you're probably voting no, honestly. And
yeah, I feel like
I was an Eagles fan, let's hear it.
Yeah, you see it, man. But, I think that objectively, when you look at this Cowboys team, there's a sense of there's a lack of a sense of direction. I remember we talked about this at the beginning of the year. I thought the fact that they went 4-0 without Dak Prescott was a sign of trouble. I know that I was a fan of the – I don't think that – because they went 4-1, Cooper Rush was someone that they should consider starting. I just thought that, sheesh, like you just paid a guy $160 million and you don't even need him to win. Like that just shows you that there's some kind of dysfunction. I think that the team doesn't know where and which direction it wants to go in. I heard that they're going to franchise tag Pollard and then we see what happens to him, and now it's like his value, you know, as you know how it is with running backs. One injury, like, and it's like, that was my first thought when his ankle snapped like on TV was, you know, like, that man was about to get paid, and this is what happened. And so
situations
like that are out of Dak's control, obviously. But he is the face of the franchise, and that's a big franchise. You have a lot of fans, and you have a lot of haters. And I think that they have continually just been disappointing. And I think so. I think it's time for something fresh in Dallas. And I think that that starts with getting rid of Zeke and Dak.
Yeah, no, Zeke and Dak drafted in the same year. They're boys, too, off the field, we saw in Hard Knocks. It's tough. I mean, I remember when Zeke was a rookie leading the league in yards, he was going crazy. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, we all saw it coming. Tony Pollard, he was a beast this year.
He was their best offensive player this year. After Lamb. By far. After Lamb.
Yeah,
after
CeeDee Lamb, definitely up there. He had a crazy year, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Ridiculous game on Sunday as well. He was the only offensive player that, you know, showed some competency out there.
He was Dak's safety net the entire season. I mean,
most definitely. I think he also covered up for the mistakes of his, you know, his teammates.
Yeah.
A lot of the praise gets sent to Dak on his ability to, you know, throw that deep ball is what the Cowboys fans love this year. They said that, oh yeah, you know, we have a good deep ball, and it's like, yeah, but he's throwing a lot of those to just one guy, and so maybe we should be talking about the guy that's catching them.
Yeah. What's interesting is Amari Cooper had a great season. And I remember we talked earlier, this is a few months ago, we were comparing Amari Cooper to CeeDee Lamb. Obviously, CeeDee Lamb ended up finishing with a better season. Browns kind of looked shaky at the end, even with Deshaun Watson back.
Yeah.
But imagine if the Cowboys kept Amari Cooper. Like, are they beating the Niners?
No.
Do they have a better offense?
They definitely have a better offense. They definitely have a better chance. They definitely score more than 12 points, you know, like. But I think that also
I'm just saying that's another 6-8 touchdowns.
Yeah. No, I understand. I think Amari Cooper would add tremendous value. I think the fact that something that the Cowboys were lacking all year was, you know, variation in the pass game. A lot of it did get predictable with just Gallup and Lamb, really. So, yeah, I mean, I think without a doubt, if they still had Amari Cooper, that team would be in a better shape. I remember all the OBJ talk, you know, as quick as it came, it's gone.
Yeah.
Like, he's not going to be able to play this year, so then the Cowboys were out of the running. But everyone was talking about that like it was a sure thing. You know what I mean? For like 2 weeks,
even
we were out
Mavericks
here.
Even the Mavericks game, bro, with Trayvon
Diggs exactly.
And Parsons.
With Parsons and all them, just courtside. Exactly. So I think that, yeah, I mean, the Cowboys and their offensive problems, we knew about them going in into the playoffs. But I think that I was actually very impressed by their defense. A lot of injuries on that side of the ball, and they still played a great game. I thought that I was more impressed with the Cowboys' defense than anything else as the year went on. And I think that that should be kind of where they focus to build, because the guys on that side of the ball are way younger, and they show more potential, I think.
Yeah,
so.
I definitely agree. Every episode, we're going to be having another segment. It's going to be community questions. We're going to have subscribers, followers, anybody who has been listening to The Breakdown. Feel free to ask a question, whether that's through Instagram, TikTok.
Instagram, TikTok.
If you really want to email us, go ahead and email us.
Yeah, like, no, Twitter, YouTube comments. Drop something in the comments.
Yeah, comments. Definitely in the YouTube comments for sure.
Literally any question you would have. Mm-hmm. There's not a topic we wouldn't care talking about, even if it's a sport or topic we haven't talked about before.
Yeah, we'll definitely pick a few of those more interesting questions, and we'll have a conversation about that.
Yeah, just make sure you guys send them in. We'd love to answer your questions. So.
Yeah, so let's get into Kansas City versus Jacksonville.
Yeah.
At Arrowhead. G-E-H-A Field at Arrowhead. This was a great game, honestly. Not really. It wasn't really a great game. Trevor Lawrence, a couple picks here and there, and that's just been the story of probably every one of Jacksonville's losses this season. Chiefs were just dominant, and that's pretty much the main takeaway. They look good, and they're going to be facing a hot Bengals team as well.
Yeah, I think watching that game, Jacksonville did all they could, really. But without a doubt, Patrick Mahomes' apparent ankle sprain in the first half loomed large. I mean, before that injury, I mean, the Chiefs were absolutely, you know, killing them. It was 17-10 at one point, at the end of the first half, and the biggest question of the game was around Patrick Mahomes' ankle. And I think that that's going to be a storyline that we hear a lot about in the next few days. But there's just, like, I think he's going to be 100% fine, good to go. They have the best medical staff, and it's just an ankle sprain. So I think that it's not worth spending too much time just talking about it. But I do think that it's a key storyline, because that's the kind of stuff that really matters in the playoffs, the fine margins.
Yeah, I totally agree. A couple seasons ago, very similar situation happened. Chad Henne had to come in and make a clutch play against Cleveland, which, crazy to think about. Cleveland could have been playing the Bills in the AFC Championship that year. Yeah. Could have been the same thing this year. Unfortunately, not. Chad Henne, he looked good when he was out there. Like, honestly,
yeah, he had a 98-yard touchdown drive.
Exactly.
You know, and then a lot of that does have to do with the fact that Kelce had a monster day.
Mm-hmm.
I think he finished with, like, what, the most catches by a tight end ever in a postseason game. I think that was the sad. He finished with 14 catches, 98 yards.
Finish as probably the best tight end we'll ever watch.
Maybe not. I think.
I don't know. As long as he's with best. Patrick Mahomes and Andy Reid, it could look pretty scary for
everyone.
I mean, Rob Gronkowski and Tony Gonzalez at the top there.
No, I think that when it's all said and done, Travis Kelce will be the best tight end. The receiving numbers he has are just, they're crazy.
Yeah. Aside from Kelce, bottom line, Patrick Mahomes, he came back.
Yeah.
A couple seasons ago, Chiefs medical staff has been great at protecting him. He hasn't missed too many games in his career.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah. There were 73,000 people at that game, by the way. That's a tough environment to play in.
Yeah, no, especially KC.
Yeah. So I think that, but with Joe Burrow, looking ahead, you know, if there's a team that can negate the home field advantage, if anyone could do it, I think that it'll be Joe Burrow. But I think that with the Jags, let's take a second and talk about them. I mean, they defied a lot of expectations just to be playing this past weekend. So, do you have any thoughts on what their outlook is? Obviously,
if you're a Jaguars fan, you have to be super excited. Not because you lost the game, because the outlook of your future.
Yeah, I don't think they're excited because they lost the game either.
Because your future looks great right now. Mm-hmm. Honestly, Trevor Lawrence, he proved a lot this year. And I remember when we were probably 4 or 5 games in, and all you could see on YouTube was why Trevor Lawrence is such a bad quarterback.
He proved me wrong.
Yeah.
He proved me wrong. I'll say a lot of
people wrong.
I think, I mean, I just didn't see this from him. The things that we criticized about him at the beginning of the year were the same things that we applauded him for at the end of the year. That's his leadership, decision-making, ability to, you know, make plays happen. At the beginning of the year, the problem literally was that he could not make any plays. Like, any time he would have to get mobile or move around outside the pocket, I feel like he just couldn't do it. He was groggy. And now he's seeing it better. I mean, I think, like, simplest way to draw it up, unless there is some crazy trick that Doug Peterson discovered and got Trevor Lawrence to play the way he has been, is just that he's matured and he sees the game better, and that he's able to, you know, go out there and execute the game plan more. And it doesn't help when you have a Super Bowl winning coach, you know, helping you out.
And it seems like he matured so quickly throughout the season, but you can't forget all the pieces this Jaguars front office went out and get over the offseason.
Yeah.
That proved a lot of people wrong as well.
Shout out Evan Kirk. Ingram and Christian Kirk.
Yeah.
Those are two of the guys that you are, I'm assuming, talking about. Two additions. They were phenomenal all year. Evan Ingram down the stretch, making that push, win the division towards the end of the year. He was phenomenal. He had a few monster games. And then Christian Kirk was...
Saved me 1 week in fantasy when he dropped, 38? He had a couple of monster games. He killed me that 169 yards or something like that.
Yeah, no. He definitely. And then Christian Kirk was another. And then Zay Jones had a crazy, three touchdown game.
Zay Jones, man.
At the end of the year. I know, you know, the way he gets up, bro.
He was a second round pick by the Bills.
Yeah. I know. I'm telling you, bro. And
he's
then
so young. That's
Travis.
The thing.
Travis Etienne, Jamichael Hasty. I mean,
Etienne. I mean, if you're a Jaguars fan, Etienne has to be your favorite player behind Trevor Lawrence. Like, dude is so electric.
Yeah. No. This is great. I'm just looking at their. You know. And then I was watching. This was probably the first Jaguars game I watched. You know, all the way through since the Colts one. Actually, I didn't even watch their playoff game last week. Because I thought it was over. But anyway, I was watching, like, Devin Lloyd. I remember him at Utah. We knew that he was going to be someone else, you know.
And very underrated. Kind of flew under the radar rookie this year.
Mm-hmm. I
had him pretty high in my rankings before the season. And, I mean, he showed up as the season went along. Mm-hmm. Not too flashy at the beginning there. But, I like the pick.
Yeah, no, I just think that, you have a lot to look forward to if you're the Jaguars. I think right now, early lock, I guess, they're back in the playoffs next year as division champs. I think they'll get to host a second straight year hosting a home playoff game.
Yeah, from, what was it? What pick they have last year?
They were the worst team in the NFL for 2 years in a row. And then
instantly. The AFC South champs.
Pretty AFC South champs.
Pretty impressive.
Yeah, I mean, they lost by a touchdown to Patrick Mahomes in Kansas City. I mean, I thought they played a wonderful game. Sometimes they don't go your way.
Covered the spread, too.
Exactly. Great. Hey, good teams win, great teams cover, right? Yeah. So,
Let's get into this next game.
The next one I thought was the best one the whole weekend. Eagles, Eagles, Giants.
38-7 blowout in Philly. Yeah. That atmosphere is kind of nuts watching the game.
Yeah, man. 5 days on the dot since we beat the Vikings 38-7 at home in the playoffs. 5 years. Oh, it was like the anniversary, I guess. But what? I mean, I don't even want to talk about this team too much. Because I feel like if you want to know who the Eagles are, go rewatch this game. Like, if you still have questions on who the Eagles are, go rewatch this game. Like, I thought that they came out there, they did exactly what they needed to do. They do what they've done all year.
Yeah. Like, Brian Daboll in his press conference, they just kept hammering with questions.
Mm-hmm.
All he could reply was just like, I don't know, that's a good offense out there. Oh, that's a good defense out there. Like,
yeah, it's
true. I mean, they have stars. Like, when you pick up, like, Linval Joseph and, like, who else did they pick up midseason? That one other Linval Joseph and...
Dude, I can't. I'm blanking. Oh, we picked up Ndamukong Suh, but he hasn't really been playing like
and
that.
Sue,
but,
yeah.
But we picked up Ndamukong Suh.
Those are guys who aren't even playing, but they're... Big name guys.
Yeah, no, I think that that's so. I think
big
in the
guys
NFL,
not getting time,
like, in the NFL, we've always had this conversation. It's like it's such a team sport. You can't just get a bunch of stars and win. But I think that the way the Eagles have done it, is that we've gotten guys that are proven at their position and at their skill level that they were still able to translate. So they're at this point where these are guys that kind of got overlooked. James Bradbury got cut by the Giants last year. You know what I mean? And he's like
a
huge contributor.
In that game too,
CJ,
bro.
Exactly. CJ Gardner-Johnson, the Saints let him go. You know,
he's
we
so
traded
good.
For him.
I can't
and like AJ Brown, like everybody else had a fair shot at AJ Brown too. It's not like we gave up anything or did anything. Like all of these, it's like Moneyball.
Yeah,
this
a
is
fair
like
pick for him, but.
We did. But I think that, I just think that the way the team has been rebuilt, all props to Howie Roseman. Yeah, man. I
didn't expect this quick of a rebuild from Philly. I don't think you could have as a fan a
I definitely
years
didn't.
Ago
I definitely
Jalen
didn't.
Hurts was drafted.
Well, and I think thought? That I think that the reason that this has even happened, the reason that they did this and went all out, is because they looked at the guy that they're looking at in that locker room at Jalen Hurts, and they were like, "He's good enough to like we're not going to waste his time by sitting around and trying to rebuild the slow way." They saw that rookie year. They saw that his first year starting that you know he does have something. The guys in the locker
he's
room
leader,
obviously
too.
Do something. Yeah, the guy, like you, we can sit here. You know, analysts can sit there and talk about it, but like. There's no, like, there's not Madden ratings above these players' heads, like, when they're in the locker room training stuff. Like, you look at the guy beside you, and you say, damn, this motherfucker's pretty good. I'm going to play with him, and I'm going to play
damn,
just as good. Like, you
ass.
Know what I mean?
I'm just kidding.
It is, bro. It is, though. he's a big guy, but he's, like, I don't know. He's agile, though. That's the thing. He's not quick. He's agile. There's a difference.
No.
He's a slight
Jalen guy. Hurts, in any clip you ever see on the internet ever, he has pretty much, like, says the perfect thing every
mm-hmm.
time. Great media presence, and you can tell, like...
He's a dog.
He's a leader.
He's a dog. We don't got to spend too much more time on the Eagles. Giants, you can talk about them if you want. I think that they're going to pay Saquon, what, $12 million is the number that they reported?
Yeah.
Christian McCaffrey gets paid 16. He'd get paid around what Joe Mixon gets paid, I think, is kind of what it is. Like
that. It's going to be a short term, but he's going to get his money here for at least another year.
If you're Saquon, you re-sign, no question, right?
I wouldn't say no question. I mean, I think there are a lot of teams that could use a running back, including the Buffalo Bills.
That would pay. Well, here's the thing with the Bills. We didn't talk about this. I guess I was going to bring it up when we do talk about the Bills. Yeah, but I think that there's a few other things. I don't think Saquon would solve very many problems for him. But I do think that...
I beg to differ.
Well, they are one-dimensional. We can talk about this. But I do think that his best option is to stay in New York. Stay with the Giants.
His best option, probably, yes. But, I mean, there could be several teams out there to... I don't know. Brian Daboll,
you never know.
The way he used him, I mean, he was back, bro. Like, rookie year Saquon, so...
Yeah, Saquon, we know when Saquon is healthy, he can change a game.
If he's going to thrive in any offense, it's going to be this Giants run-heavy offense.
Mm-hmm. So. That's also true. And I think that after this year, I mean, that locker room has got to be... I would rather be in the Giants locker room than be in the Cowboys locker room right now. Just as a player, as a personnel or whatever. Yeah. Just because
I agree.
There's a certain level of optimism.
Definitely
there's
a lot more disappointment in Dallas.
Yeah, and I understand that both these teams, I'm not trying to compare them on any other level. I'm just saying that from a purely, you know, chemistry standpoint, locker room standpoint, I think that what Saquon means to them is so much. And the
he's
Giants mean so
he's
much
been
for
there
Saquon.
Since
yeah,
day
no,
one, since
think,
Eli Manning was there, man.
And he's you know, he's been a part of this New York Giant culture heavily.
For sure.
We've seen it. We have some Giants fans. We know how much they love Saquon. I expected the Eagles to cover comfortably. I think the line was set at 4.5. I mean, I saw this as one of those, like, 7, 8, 9-point wins that the Eagles get where they go out early in the first half and then just kind of ease their foot off the gas pedal.
Yeah, unfortunately, I was a victim of +7.5 Giants. So
that's what happens when you listen to Ethan Audie too much.
I'm also a victim of Bill's money line against the Bengals.
I made hella money on that, by the way.
This game, very disappointing. By the way, I want to introduce Wade. He just hopped back in, so he's going to be talking here a little bit.
Yeah, unfortunately, I'm a little busier this semester, so it's going to be a lot more of Tyler and Pal. But I'll hop in when I can. Yeah, just got back from a little bit story I'm doing. You can check it out on the Carolina News Reporter. Wednesday afternoon is when it'll
plug.
It'll be a cool one. It's about this guy who runs a nonprofit after school program for soccer for kids. So if you want to check that out, well, I'll plug it later. But yeah, I mean, this was always just a game where.
Wait on, but before you go, by the way, my mom said. When she listens to our podcast, she loves your podcast voice.
Dude, I've gotten that same. I got one where it was like, the guy on the left has the best podcast.
That's what
voice.
I'm saying. She's like, the guy who talks first does it really well.
That's why he talks first. And Tifa's his mom.
I do. I have a little bit of formal training podcast. Well, not really formal training.
Yeah.
But like being in the Jason.
Yeah, no.
You'll have to listen to our dumbasses.
The more you do it, and obviously you had that podcast earlier, the more you do, you kind of recognize like you got to improve some things and like how you talk and stuff like that. I mean, I've realized that I used to say a lot. I know Pal still does it. Pal's a guy.
I say
like a lot still.
T. Bush like, with the yes but or no but or
yeah but
yeah T. Bush. But anyway, let's just let's get back on topic here. Next game we wanted to talk about.
Bills Bengals.
Yeah, Wade.
Yeah, I just wanted like so watching this game in the snow. Great. I mean, you can't beat the environment out there in Buffalo, or as I learned, Orchard Park, technically. Mm-hmm. This weekend. This was always just a game where, like, I was watching it, and I was just like, all right, this is the drive where Josh Allen turns it on, and we get a great game, and then it just never happened, and Cincinnati played very well defensively. I think it's tough playing in that kind of weather when you're a big shot play offense, like the Bills are, so that definitely had an effect, but it was just, like, kind of an odd game. This was the biggest anti-climax of the weekend, for sure, for me.
Yeah, no, as a Bills fan, this game sucked, and if you're a Bengals fan, I think you agree too. I mean, definitely you're happy that your team won, but like the Bills were not able to do anything. Like, if you're able to run all over us and then stop the big shot plays like you were talking about, Gabe Davis, Stephon Diggs, like they limited him. We saw Stephon Diggs; he's like pissed at that.
I was gonna say, what are your thoughts? What are your thoughts on that? Did you think like he was justified? That's just how he is, bro.
Like he's just always gonna be a diva. He literally has an assistant keeping floss on the sidelines for him. He flosses on the sideline, so like he gets a lot of privilege as a Buffalo Bill. I can tell you that. I don't really see any other player get that treatment, but I mean. That's just how wide receivers are. Like, they're divas. I'm a big Diggs guy anyways.
The floss on the sideline is – I know it one – like, no seemingly, like, harmless thing has ever maybe become less of a guy for a guy than it just
is. Stephon Diggs is, like, huge about his health and dental care, especially.
Dental hygiene is key for him.
He loves his dental – like, we're not – he's a huge candy guy. Listen to this, bro. He's like a huge like Starburst guy. And they're so. We watched his. I think we're both talking about the same. There's this GQ. There's a GQ 10 things, dude. Rashford has one. That's amazing, by the way. The GQ top things you can't live about athlete section, in my opinion, is the greatest thing on YouTube.
There's so many.
They have every athlete you would like. My favorite. There's one with Carlos Sainz and Max and like. Oh, so they have every.
Jalen Hurts has one.
Anyway, yeah. So Diggs, he talks about that in his a lot. He's a big dental health guy. But I wanted to talk about. Honestly, I wanted to talk more about the Bengals and the Bills. I don't think that the Bills lost this game per se. I just think that the Bengals just went out and won it, and they knew that. The Bengals knew that if they're able to run the ball successfully, even with. Three of their, you know, five starting offensive linemen out, they were going to be able to win the game, and that's what they did. And I think that the fact that the Bengals are so balanced is what makes them so good this time of year.
I, like, you're saying that, and if we're going past, like, or if we're going back a couple weeks, like, I disagree with you, but at this point, like, yeah. Like,
just the past 2 weeks.
They just played so great defensively, like, as of late, and... What they did well is they ran the ball to the outside. The Bills, like you said, are great at containing the plays before they happen.
Yeah.
They limit their yards as soon as they get to the running back quick before he's able to gain speed. Joe Mixon was gaining speed running laterally. And that's what he's good at. And for the Bengals, what I've seen all season is that if they're able to run the game, then or run the ball the entire game, they win that game. Because Joe Burrow is gonna make his plays, Jamar Chase is gonna make his plays. If Joe Mixon is on, they're no doubt like winning that game.
I also think that missing Von Miller was bigger yesterday than it was.
Defense has been really hurt as of late for the Bills, and I think all year there were glimpses where they weren't the same. Leslie Frazier needs to be fired. That is now three losses in the playoffs, like where we Chiefs, Bengals, and we got ripped apart in all three of those losses. I don't care.
You blew a lead the second time against the Chiefs as well. Blew that 13-point lead.
Exactly. I don't care if we only let up 3 points to the Patriots in the divisional round, or we just let up 30 to the Dolphins. Like that is definitely a problem
with
Skylar Thompson.
Yeah, I mean, my whole takeaway from this game is that. For one thing, the AFC is a lot better than the NFC from this divisional weekend. Yeah. I think at the top, both conferences' top two teams, I think, are pretty even. And I think for the conference championships, we have two. Those are the four. I think they are the four best teams in football.
Yeah. Without a doubt, in my opinion.
And even though, like, you know, the Niners weren't that convincing over the Cowboys, we have. I think four juggernauts, and it's going to come down to who is good on the defensive side of the ball. And all four teams had dominant defensive performances before the championship, and we've seen that's what it takes to get there. Bill's going to get it done.
It's interesting you say that because now, out of the four teams left, the team with the worst defense is Kansas City. In my opinion, I think that's pretty easy to take away.
Usually,
that's
turn
one
up
story
in the playoffs.
Line.
Yeah.
That's also true, but I didn't think they looked particularly good against Jacksonville. Maybe, you know, rust. They did just come off a bye week, but
Jacksonville is known for coming back. We saw against the Chargers, that was a clear example, but all season, really. They're able to score, I wouldn't say garbage time points, but a lot of fourth quarter points. So that's one thing to consider.
Yeah. One more note I wanted to just get in before we are moving on from the Bills. The last Pro Bowler the Bills drafted was Josh Allen in 2018. They haven't drafted a Pro Bowler since.
Matt Milano. Or, wait, that, he that, wasn't a that was before. That was
yeah.
Before,
yeah. Yeah. Before. 2018.
Pro Bowler.
That's okay. A crazy stat. Even isn't Bears, that? Even the Bears have drafted more Pro Bowlers since then.
Let's go. Exactly. So, I think that also that, like, that's in football, weird. In football, it's yeah. Very, it's, the teams that are winning in football.
I hate that stat because Jordan Poirier was literally the number one ranked safety and didn't
yeah,
make
because
the Pro Bowl.
Of, well, he, didn't he that get hurt?
The same year. No. He literally made first team All-Pro and didn't make the Pro Bowl. So, Pro Bowl stat, you can, I like talking about All-Pro and
yeah, maybe you there's a reason why that stat didn't say All Pro and like, and said Pro Bowl, but I just think that again, regardless, you're
sure,
you can
JJ
still
Watt's like only a 4-time Pro Bowler. Like, but you that's can kind of ridiculous. It's only 4-time Pro Bowler.
Yeah. I understand. So I'm just saying. Still, you guys have only like again, just don't analyze it too much and just take it for what it is. It's the fact that you're still only able to come up with 2 or 3 different names for guys that you guys have drafted in the last. Like I can think of 3 Eagles players
I'm
drafted in the last 2 years.
I'm
just agreeing
with the point that we have talent. And you just don't know about
it. I think that there's a difference, though, in the way you get that talent. And a big part of maintaining success
in the
NFL
is drafting. If you go back for,
drafting.
Like, the next, like, past 3 years, there's a bunch of guys on that defense who have won at least one award. Tre'Davious White, All-Pro corner.
Yeah.
That's Jordan Poirier, Micah Hyde, name. Both All-Pros at least one time. Micah Hyde was hurt for the playoffs. Matt Milano just won All-Pro. Jermaine Edmonds was
Matt Milano,
a first-rounder who will get paid this offseason.
I think that it just
I just
does,
don't think
like,
you know, like, a bunch of their defensive players. That's my point.
No, that's true. I'm just saying that, like, objectively still.
They do, yeah. The Bills, I forgot
I'm not
about
saying the Bills aren't talented. They're one of the best teams in the NFL.
He was hurt. But Mike Hyde, one of the best players I've ever watched in college life by a wide margin.
He's a freak.
Iowa. He was incredible. Yeah. He was incredible at Iowa.
Damn.
Like,
ball hard
too. First team,
though.
Oh, like, tons of picks. Yeah. He was the one that kind of, we had a Iowa had a nice little DBU era that ended, if you remember, Josh Jackson.
DBU era.
Yeah.
That ended with Josh Jackson after he was a bust, and Micah Hyde kind of started all that there. There was a sprinkling of first and second round DBs out of Iowa. But, yeah, he's incredible. I think that the Bills going forward, they have to, like, just come back and just – you got to be able to move the ball. I think that was their biggest problem.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, they couldn't get a stop. Yeah, the Bengals were running all over them, but the offense couldn't stay on the field. Their defense, like, I mean, that wears on you after a while. I mean, they still only gave up 27 points, I mean, which is a lot, but, like, when it's 3 and out, it's 5, 6 plays and out, that starts to wear on you as a defensive player, especially when a team was running the ball as well as the Bengals were.
And that's not what we saw all season. Like, I think they just hit a rough patch in the road, like, really. Like, they just had their worst game of the season, just happened to be in the divisional round. Before we move on to the next game, mm-hmm. Let's talk about the future of the Bills team. You mentioned that Saquon Barkley little tangent we were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Devin Singletary is not a good enough running back for this Bills team, and the main reason why is because he can't break out large runs like any other running back can. James Cook can.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, like, a guy like Saquon Barkley, I think, would be, I know he's going to cost a little bit, but I think mm-hmm. will be amazing because he presents another threat. We can't just have Diggs. We can't – Gabe Davis didn't even play that well this season. We can't just have Josh Allen running the ball every game. We need – I like James Cook. He'll be very productive, but we need another running back.
Yeah.
Do you guys think Diggs stays?
I think Diggs stays.
Yes.
I think that it's much easier.
Diggs doesn't have the production he does without Josh Allen.
This is what I'm talking about, though, with the Bills, though. It's the fact that I know you guys can go out and get Saquon, but, like, with running backs, isn't it just better to just build it through the draft? Like,
yeah,
I
know. And that's why
I just think
James
that,
Cook.
And I think that that's what, yeah, and I agree with the James Cook thing.
I would
I'm
love
just,
Saquon, that's obviously, but, I mean, Von Miller scared me with paying that all that money.
Bijan Robinson. Mm,
that's a good name, too.
Do you guys have
David
a first
Montgomery,
round, do you guys
bro?
Have a first round pick. David
Montgomery, is available this, like, and so that's what I'm saying. I think with the Bills, they don't need to go and get, like, an absolute game changing. They just need someone that can literally get them yards on the ground. And I think that a lot of that just comes from the fact that they're a very one dimensional offense, and that comes from the coordinators and the personnel that they have.
That's what I'd say for the Bills. If they have a first round draft pick, which I'm not sure if they do, I did not have time to do research, but just sprinkle that late round draft pick on Bijan Robinson. I've heard he's dropping to even early second round, and he, I mean, he's a freak. And he would be,
that'd be so good.
He'd be a perfect, I won't say change. I won't say change of pace back because James Cook is also kind of a hammer, but just like a very nice 1-2 punch.
James Cook is less of a hammer than Bijan Robinson.
That is true. I would wonder though if they would want someone who is a little bit better at catching passes out of the backfield.
That's James.
That's something that they stressed.
That's what James Cook does. That's not what they got Hines for. Hines was just for punt returns. They have James Cook. He's just a rookie, so like it was tough. Like that was their guy doing that, and like he doesn't have the experience. So that's why like you can't have Singletary and Cook going into the playoffs like that when you're not passing the ball like you did last year, you know. But let's get into the next game, pal. What do you think from this? What conclusions do you draw from this Niners win?
I think they're as good as advertised. With everyone except for the quarterback. I mean, I know that Brock Purdy's a rookie and like this is his fourth, fifth start, whatever. But I think that eventually the magic will run out. I genuinely thought that they were gonna lose yesterday. I hate the Cowboys. I know how good this Niners team is, but you know how the NFL is sometimes, and there's just like these wacky games. And I genuinely thought that the Bengals and the Cowboys were both gonna win yesterday. And I didn't have, like, I can't explain it to him. It's like, oh, yeah, like, I think this is what's, I just, like, it's just one of those things where, you know, sometimes that's just what happens. And I think that with Brock Purdy, we're getting to the point where he eventually loses. But I'm not sure. I think that they'll
ever lose in the NFL ever again.
Exactly. like, that's what we say, right? But then if he wins, let's just say hypothetically Brock Purdy goes ahead and wins the Super Bowl. What do you do if you're... Well, I know that they said that Garoppolo.
He'd have more.
Bro, he should retire. That's what he should do.
He'd have more Super Bowl wins than wins over Iowa, and he was at Iowa State for 4 years. So I'm just going to put that out there. I would say on the Brock Purdy front, I mean, we actually talked about this the other day, that, like, that's the point that you need to attack because, I mean, there's really no other point to attack on this Niners team. They're ridiculous at literally every position.
Kittle? Has been, you know.
Kittle is a top two tight end. Debo Samuel's
brother linebackers. Top Warner and Greenlaw.
Fred Warner had an insane game. He, from the linebacker position, he affects the game like no one else.
At every, I won't say every position group, but at every level on offense and defense, they have a top three player at their position. It's incredible.
So do the Birds. This will be a great matchup. This NFC Championship matchup.
This is going to be a crazy game.
We've been talking about this for, you know, 4 months now, that this will be the eventually NFC East NFC Championship matchup. It's what it is. It's what we got. Who do you guys think wins?
Oh, God.
I'm sorry, pal. I have to go with the Niners. I want to bring back the argument that I know you hate. I'm going to say this, but Jalen Hurts just played the Giants.
That's fair. I actually wanted to play the Niners. I was talking to Theo Hahn, shout out.
And that'd be great for you.
I told him.
And your points, yeah.
I said that I'd rather play the Niners because at least then I'll know that either A, the Eagles are fakes and like, you know, we literally didn't play anyone in the regular season. But or we'll win and then like no one will be able to use this conversation again. Like I understand that like the Eagles playing the NFC East, it's been that way for 100 years. So like I don't know what to say about the fact that we hate to play the Giants and them. But I think that week after week after week after week after week after week after week, Jalen Hurts just kept playing good football. Like I don't, I understand the sample size isn't big enough. Maybe the fact that the team is so good around him, the fact that he has AJ Brown and Devonta Smith, I understand that's a luxury. But, yeah, I think he'll surprise some people.
This is a tough one. I am going to go with Philadelphia. And I understand that Brock Purdy has been something of a revelation for the San Francisco 49ers. However, I want you to, like, look at what Brock Purdy is doing. And, like, what would be so wildly different if Jimmy Garoppolo was still healthy. Because I don't think it's much. He does throw the ball down the field more effectively than Jimmy Garoppolo, but I still think that this Niners team is just steamrolling people.
I think that's a little bit of a disrespectful take to Brock Purdy.
Brock Purdy
I think is a lot more mobile than people think, and he takes a lot more shots than Jimmy does downfield.
Yeah, I'd say the mobility is also, I did not mention that, the mobility is also a big advantage, but I think they do like that shot play because, like, those shot plays, because, like, of what a genius Shanahan is that opens up his underneath game and the run game, which is just unstoppable when they get it going. Exactly. But Brock Purdy, he wasn't good against the Cowboys. I thought he was okay. I thought he was average.
Yeah, I agree. I think he had one or two outstanding games this year. Yeah. Other than that, it's just been average.
I honestly think that was his worst game that he's played, and he still won.
He was bad in the first half against the Seahawks.
I think we saw two of the best defenses in the league. I thought that was
the fuck
a big...
up after, though.
That's the other thing that we shouldn't like overrate the effect that the Cowboys had on, like, the Cowboys defense had on him as well.
But again, the Cowboys. Here's what I'll say. The Niners put up 19 at home. Or, I'm sorry.
The
Niners put up 19 at home. Come on, man. Like, I think that, like, at some point, I understand that the running offense is so good. And I understand that, you know, they have Christian McCaffrey. They have probably a line that's the best in the NFL. You know, they have Trent Williams, who's the best offensive line player in the NFL, period. And I think that the way that they use their running game is better than any team in the NFL. But I do think that overall, the thing that sent the Niners over the top a few years ago was the big play, that big play ability. And I think that unless they can somehow get Debo going, like, Debo, I want to say he only has, like, 100 or 200 yard receiving games in the past, like,
doesn't need to get 100 receiving yards games anymore, though. That's the thing. Like, there's that much better.
And they have,
and Brandon Ayuk is a lot better now. Yeah. But he's one of the best. I was gonna shout him out because, like, some of the routes he runs are.
I think he's 30. Been also, yeah, the fact that people wrote him off after a year or whatever was just crazy.
I traded him in Dynasty.
He's their wide receiver one, like, right now, like. Debo might be the better
wide
receiver.
He's more of a true wide receiver than Debo is.
That's also true, yeah. And I think, here's what I wanted to bring up. It's just the fact that we were just talking about how it hurts teams in the playoffs to be so one-dimensional. And I think that, like, even though the Eagles' rush defense isn't, you know, we're average. Like, it's an average rush defense. Tell me what happens when the Eagles go up 14-0 like they have been on every single team that they've played this year. Like, the Eagles that are the... They outscore opponents by more than 10 every second quarter. So, realistically, if this game just plays out by the averages, the Eagles are going to have a lead in the first half. How do you come back when you have Brock Purdy and a running offense?
We've seen it. I mean, he did it. Obviously, it was the Seahawks, and it was away. It was at home. But, like, that was the question coming in. And
yeah, but you can't compare the Seahawks to...
We did see him handle it, and I think that with how the 49ers are able to control the clock... it'll be a little bit different, like, in terms of just, like, the pace of the game. I mean, because, like, you're right, against the Giants, it was over almost before it even started the game. It was 14-0 in 5-10 minutes.
All right, so let's get to our next matchup, the AFC Championship. Chiefs will be home against the Bengals. Refund those tickets.
Besides the worrying reports that the NFL may look into neutral site conference championship games now anyway, I think that would be a very, very bad move. That was a hilarious line. This might even be a harder game to pick, at least in my opinion.
I think it is.
I'm going to go...
That's what Vegas says as well. Lines opened at... Let me give you 10 more seconds to think before you say it. Lines opened at Chiefs minus 120, Bengals even. And then in the NFC, the spread was at 1 point to the Chiefs.
Wow.
Now it's moved to 1.5. And then the Eagles-Niners game, that one opened at 1.5 to the Eagles. It's moved to 2.5 to the Eagles.
Yeah. I'm going to go with the Chiefs. I really like... Pacheco, I think he brings them a different dimension that they didn't have last year just someone. I mean, Clyde Edwards-Helaire, obviously, he's injured. But he's not a guy who you'll just hand the ball off to and he'll put his head down and pick up 4 yards, 5 yards. Pacheco is that guy. He runs angry. And, you know, with Mahomes at Arrowhead, Carolina so close. But
if you just look at the last 7 weeks, I think it's pretty clear to tell that the Bengals are one of the two or three best teams in the NFL, not even close. I really, really, really want to just say it that they'll win, but I just can't. Like you, I think we've gotten to the point where you cannot legitimately look at a game Patrick Mahomes is going to play in and say that he will lose. I think we've gotten to that point, and I won't do it. So I'm going to pick the Chiefs as well. What do you got, Tyler?
I agree with you guys. I like the Chiefs as well.
Hammer Cincinnati, bro, yeah. As soon as we get done recording.
So that should be the lock for this weekend.
No, don't say that. No. There's no lock, man.
The lock is Travis Kelce first touchdown.
I'm going to be cheering for Joe Burrow, though. Just, you know, for the record.
I know.
Like,
we all know you're...
Oh, yeah.
Profess your love for Joe Burrow.
Oh, dude, I love him. I'll say it, man. But anyway, one last segment to get into.
Yeah, so our locks, we're just getting
the... Yeah, we'll talk about our locks, right?
Yeah, we'll talk about our locks. So
this is an episode made for Tuesday, the 24th, so these games that we're about to talk about, they're happening on Tuesday.
Yeah, they're actually about to happen tonight.
Oh, yours is happening...
Because...
Okay.
No, so is yours. Yours is happening tonight, too.
My bad. Yeah, yeah. Because it's tonight. Sorry. You guys are listening to it. Yeah, my bad. So these locks are for games happening tonight.
Yeah, so any sport, really.
Yeah, who do you got?
My lock. I'm going Sabres +1.5 against the Blues. They're only 4 points away from the playoff spot, Buffalo is.
Dang.
Blues, a little spotty as of late. Sabres are on a... Are 2-0 in their last two matchups against the Blues.
Nice.
So that's my data supporting that lock.
That's a good one. I got for my lock, I have the Heat winning at home against the Boston Celtics. I don't have any stats. I just have one thing to say. Marcus Smart is not gonna play. So that's the reasoning I got. We know how good Miami is, you know, at home. And it'll be a great matchup.
It's a great pick. Great pick. And Wade, any college basketball picks?
I was just
different direction. Maybe.
Looking, yeah, I was like just looking at my little. It's just the ESPN app, but just at all my scores here, and one game has caught my eye. It's tomorrow. Big 12 matchup.
Big 12 matchup.
Yes, Big 12 best conference in college basketball this year. If you haven't been following, it is Kansas at Baylor. Kansas just got housed by TCU at home. They're going to be playing angry. Kansas -2 over Baylor tomorrow is my lock.
Lock it in,
bro. Make some money on a Tuesday night.
That's your lay of the day.
Lay of the day! I like it, dude. We were thinking of a name for this, and we couldn't. We were just like, fuck it. We'll just call it Lock of the Day.
There you go.
And
just named it.
That's live, dude. You guys heard that. This is... T. Bush is different, guys.
All right.
Cue that Kodak song.
Yeah, I remember that. We'll catch you guys on the next episode. Hope you enjoyed listening to us rant about sports, some analysis. Give us a thumbs up. Follow us. We're at 2K subscribers on YouTube now, so
maybe more than 50
maybe a little
views.
More engagement in the comments. Yeah, and that too. So
yeah. No, but seriously. I hope people comment. Comment some questions.
Yeah, comment, please. We need questions. Remember, from the beginning of the episode.
Yeah.
Peace.